Thank you so much, Jen, and thanks to Hospital Rooms for having me here today. And it's really nice to be able to be beamed into all your different spaces today for this workshop, Hybrid Totems. So maybe I'll just give you a little introduction to me. As said, I'm Michelle Williams Gamaker. I'm an artist that works with films, making moving image. So my works tend to be shown in galleries, museums, and film festivals. And when I make my films, one of the things that's really important to me is thinking about performance with my actors, and also thinking really carefully about the types of images that I want to be seen within the film, the costumes that my performers wear, and also the props that I place on my film sets. So I'm really always thinking about how my film will look. And before I get on film sets, I spend a lot of time thinking about the process of filmmaking as a process of collaging. So I like to get images, and I like to work with them to actually spend time putting things together that might not really feel like they belong together. So things that, as you'll see in the workshop, might be unexpected, but then you'll find this really good fit. And I've found that to be a really productive way of encouraging my writing to take new avenues. So sometimes when you work through paper and collaging, it can kind of unlock something in a character and see your, you know, script in a different light. So this really is a really good strategy, not just for making film, but in your life. So why do I start with looking at animals? Well, that's a good question. I'm showing you, some of you will have the resource packs. I've got this LaRousse animal portraits book, which it's really beautiful, actually. You'll see that, you know, they're really stunning plates, as they were called, that and I suppose why I'm interested in plants and the animal kingdom is I take a lot of comfort from seeing how plant life and animal life adapt to new environments around them, or to the environment that they exist within. Adaptation in the plant and animal kingdom is really very much all about survival. And when thinking about this in relation to the past year, I think that that's really relevant. It's been a really intense year for so many of us, and living through a pandemic has required, I guess, a newfound resilience that we've needed to deal with the world as it changes. And that's all about adaptation. So I guess, you know, these animals, you know, they were documented a long time ago, and in a way I'm taking inspiration from them. And I think that maybe we can do a little bit of that today in our session. So for today's workshop, we'll be exploring images in black and white and in colour. I'll just start showing you a few things here. So some of you may have seen this bear already. I think that if I had a totem, I wouldn't mind being a brown bear, a grizzly maybe sometimes in the morning. So yeah, the fact that we're using black and white and colour, I like to mix that up a bit, because we're using two different, we're using photography, old photography, and we're using plates, images that were painted, and, you know, anatomically correct images, you could say, of animals. So for this, most of the time we can just tear, and I'm using this tiny, I think they're not protractors, I don't know what this is called, but it's a triangular shaped, triangular shaped ruler, but any shatterproof ruler would be fine. And you tear down the image, and then finding a natural point, really, what we're going to start looking for is how we can connect things that don't really belong together. I mean, there's no right or wrong to this. I like to find points of connection between limbs. So following this, we could actually get this spot on. This iguana actually is a perfect marriage with a bear because there you go. And now it looks like the bear's looking into the great beyond, but the iguana say, oh, I'm not ready yet. Or don't jump, let's just slow down. But then I've got this beautiful pink gala from Australia. And maybe this isn't such a dramatic one, but I tore a white stalk in half. Sounds a bit more violent than it needs to be. And I'm looking for, again, points of connection. And interestingly, they can be found. Look at that. See how the feathers of the stalk, the crest of the feathers, start to kind of make a kind of mini wing up there on the gala. And beautifully, the white section of the wing literally dovetails into the black feathers of the stalk. And I love that the stalk's at a jaunty angle. It's like it's kind of relaxing in a nonchalant way, but also showing off a little bit. So that's another way we can do things. What I'm trying to do at the minute is not rush us. I think we've got a lot of images in the resource pack, and if we go straight into, you know, gluing things down, we lose our options. So I've got a paintbrush here, but a PVA spatula would be fine. And I'm just using basic PVA, but if you've got Pritt Stick, it's absolutely fine. I'm trying to not rush us to immediately choose to stick something down, because I could glue this into position, but then maybe I need these legs for later. So let's not overcommit ourselves. Let's keep going. This one, this image, I was actually not sure what creature this is. If anyone knows, please tell me. But I think it's some kind of marsupial, possibly rodent-like creature. Sorry, I don't know what it is. But it looks to me like it's a little bit frightened. Or maybe it's guarding something. Maybe it's guarding its young. And I sort of thought that this creature might look a little bit like, embody a little bit like how we might have been feeling over the past few months. So I'm interested in it too, because it almost looks like it's a mountain, you know. It's got this lovely mountainous structure. But amazingly, I think that it could do with another interaction. And I have actually cut this one out, but you don't have to do that. I think what I'm doing here is bringing in something called the diadem sea urchin, which is quite a kind of thorny, spiky creature. And I want to see what happens if I put together an underwater animal with a mammal. Just curious, because I feel like they'd be a really unlikely duo. But in my discoveries in the studio, I found something really nice happening between the diadem sea urchin and the creature of undefinable name. Just, I think that, what do you think? I think that the eye connects, and I think that's, it's really magic. I think that this, they belong together. There's like a curve just perfectly there. Can you see? And I think that it seems to even kind of mirror the shape of the face here. And I think that's really one of those serendipitous lucky moments with collage. But I'm also going to see what happens if I add some thorns, almost a bit like a porcupine.
We've had someone let us know, Michelle, that animal might actually be a Vermont fisher bear.
Thank you. I needed to know. Thank you for this. So a Vermont fisher
bear.
Now, thing is, it does have a really long tail. So just putting that out there, because it also feels a bit marsupial, but I think whoever's given me that information is far more knowledgeable than me. So we're going with the Vermont fisher bear and the diadem sea urchin. But I'm just interested, can you sort of see how things begin to layer? And I've got a boa constrictor here. I don't know whether that's going to be too busy. I think it might be, but I think I don't want to overcomplicate this one. So at the minute, we're not gluing down, we're just looking. This is a beautiful spotted genet. And I think that what's nice about these two, this is the boa constrictor from South America and the genet. It's interesting to kind of see the wavy connection between their tails. But I'd like to sort of see them merge in some way. You know, animals are so incredible because of their capacity to camouflage and, almost dissolve into their landscape. Sometimes I want to dissolve into the landscape and not be so visible. And I think we can learn a lot from animals and their ability to kind of be present but not be visible. So, right, still daydreaming and still exploring. I wonder if you're exploring alongside me or whether you're just pondering at this moment. I am very interested in this giraffe. We're going to do some tearing in a minute. And again, excuse my poor knowledge of primates. I'm going to guess this is a baboon of sorts. Tell me if I'm wrong, please. How could a giraffe and a primate sit together? What would that look like? And why would we do it? Why would we do it to these wonderful creatures? Well, I have had the great privilege of going to the Kruger National Park in South Africa and just managed to see the most incredible giraffe. And tearing along here, again, you could also tear horizontally. You know, you could segment off the giraffe this way, but I'm going vertically because the reason I'm doing that with this is there's a kind of verticality with this primate. So they've got such wonderful long arms, presumably for swinging and moving through the treetops. So let's give this baboon some amazing shoulder pads.
This looks absolutely amazing, Michelle.
Thank you.
I just want to say a big hello to Sophia from the Lady Well unit in Lewisham. Hello to everyone joining us there. We'd love to hear where everyone else is joining us from today, so please pop that into the Q&A below.
Ladywell is just around the corner from me. That's really nice, Sophia, that you're watching with your group. I think this is pretty lovely. I mean, I don't know how the giraffe feels about it, but I think the baboon would be pretty chuffed to get a bit of extra height, really. So that's one thing we could do, but I'm not going to do that yet. I'm still thinking. We've split this giraffe up, and I think that there's more we can do with that splitting. I think that there are other points of connection. I don't know whether this giraffe is particularly successful in this process of helping me connect, but this is an incredible bison. And I've often thought of bison, been interested in bison and musk oxen and their ability to kind of really form mountain ranges. In my films, I often have this recurring motif of mountain ranges, and I have what I've been drawing and thinking about creatures like this, and their kind of strength and solidity and their pack mentality and how they group together. They are, I can give you a fun fact, even-toed ungulates, which means that they have hooves, and they've got two of them. So, but I just love the word ungulate. So, maybe that goes there. What about, I don't think we want to lose the head of this creature. I wonder if we could fit another bit in there. So we've caused a split. Well, that's interesting. He's a bit top heavy, but I'm really interested in that character of Dr. Doolittle's, the push me, pull you, how, in a way, maybe that's part of how I feel sometimes. Don't want to make decisions all the time. And there's a little bit of, do I go this way? Do I go that way? And I think that this is, yeah, maybe I'm making a hybrid totem that is a little bit like my personality. I mean, I end up making decisions because I think at a certain point you have to, but I think it's nice that we could maybe in your units and around in your homes, you could start connecting with some of the animals in the resource pack and think through the different qualities that you might connect with them. I mean, I'd love it if I could understand what the animals would say about their own qualities. I'd love to give the animals more agency here, but in the absence of that, I'm just going to guess what I've spent a lot of time watching nature documentaries, what I think they're about. Now look at that. That is starting to feel like this tiger. What do you think? It's almost like the leg, the hind leg. The hind leg seems to connect there quite nicely.
We've got lots of units joining us today, Michelle.
Oh, so good.
Hello from Maudsley Hospital, from Rob and the women on ES1.
Hello, all of
you.
Hello to all of you.
Hello from Lavender Ward from Queen Mary's. Rose Ward in Roehampton, Cyrena House in Plymouth, and a big hello from Phoenix Ward as well.
Oh, thank you so much. It's so nice. I wish we could all teleport into spaces, but it's actually been so good with all of the different lockdowns to be able to connect digitally. Like I'm such a hugely grateful for our connection online, because so here we go. I'm actually doing a little bit of tearing here. You'd think it would be tricky, but if you keep your ruler to the line, you can get quite a lot of control out of it. I don't think it is actually about being too perfect, but as close as you can tear and more or less keep to the line. Okay, I said that and then I tore a bit, but there you go.
We have another hello. It's so great. Thanks everyone for popping in where you're coming from. It's great to see all the different units and some that we've even done past projects or workshops with. We have another hello from the ladies on Avocet Ward at Ipswich Hospital, having some great fun today.
This is nice. It feels like listening to all of these hellos. It's like we're traveling around the country. It's nice. Okay, so I've torn a bit of this. That gives us a bit more flexibility because I was covering the head of this bison and I don't want to do that. I wonder if what would happen if we went off in this direction. Ha, that's interesting. I think this is interesting anyway. Tell me if you agree. That's changing everything because I'd been keeping the legs down and I think that actually we can go up. That really changes how we... Looks like it's relaxing or stretching. And maybe, maybe we can do that as well. I think actually it's fun to not glue down actually for the moment, for the time being. I wonder though, I need to probably do a bit of tearing here because I want to see more of the bison. So give me a moment, bear with me.
And while you're doing that, Michelle, we've got lots more hellos coming through. Hello to Laurel Ward, Queen Mary's. Hello from Wharton Ward, from the Ladywell unit. It's really amazing to see so many units kind of returning back to the Digital Art School. And just a reminder that you can upload your artworks from today's session on our website. We absolutely love to see them.
Well, that would be so good, actually, to see what you make. I'd find that really inspiring, I'm sure. Others would. What I haven't done is because there's not really enough time now, but maybe as a group you could, once you've made your hybrid totem, just take a little bit of time to actually maybe write down what you have made and maybe how it makes you feel, or you know, some of the, it doesn't have to be a lot of text. It could just be keywords, you know, just that would be useful, I think, because then you'd have a little moment to kind of reflect on the process. Today it feels a little bit like we don't have enough time for that, but right, so we had those there. And remember I just did a bit of tearing because I wanted to connect the hind of the bison. That's interesting. Would I want the head to be so close? Maybe not. Maybe I'd want it to do that. Yeah. And then maybe this one to come back into position here. One thing you can do is if you're not ready to glue things down, but you want to kind of keep it in position, you can always use a bit of masking tape and tape it into position if you want to. Just but you know, let's keep things flexible. So that's one. I think we will just, you know, let's just do a little bit of gluing now, just so that. Maybe I should commit to this. Come on, let's do it. Let's start with this one.
So for the creature that you're gluing down now, Michelle,
can
you talk to us maybe about the kind of environment that you see it living within, how you
yeah.
see adapting?
Really good question. I think that, you know, giraffe live in savanna and drier territories. And of course, their long necks are adapted to reaching the treetops and picking all the leaves and the juicy leaves. And yet the bison, well, you know, they're much lower to the ground. But I'm wondering if through making this, we're giving both the option of moving to one another's territories. I don't know. I mean, actually, what I've done here is make something quite impossible in a way. And I think that that's also okay, because sometimes we need to think fantastically and maybe I've not made the most practical animal, and that also is very true about me. I'm not that practical, but I think that that lack of practicality, if I may be so bold, is a good thing if you're a filmmaker, because you can make quite big leaps in what you'd like and in your imagination. And I would like us to not be too, because today I'd like this to be a kind of fun workshop too. I'd like you to also have fun with the fantasy element of this as well. But yeah, let's see what happens here. I do have another one that I would like us to. Yeah, this one is relaxing a bit. I feel like it's doing a quite generous yoga move. I don't know what you'd call that. The giraffe, bison, mega stretch. Well, one thing I know that I am, not that I know very much or can claim very much, is that I am a Leo. So with that in mind, this lioness, which is actually, I think this is an old collage of mine that I've scanned and sent to you, because it has a tiger lurking in the background, and I'm not entirely sure what a lion and a tiger would be doing together so much. Earlier on, do you remember when I showed you the pink gala bird and the stork? Well, I ended up cutting out the top part of the stork. And I think that I want to just see what would happen if we put an incredible big cat like a lion, a lioness, together with a bird. I mean, the only way I could justify this is I might be a Leo, but I've always wanted to fly. Not that storks probably, well, storks fly, of course they do. But, you know, I think maybe I'd be a smaller bird. But outside of that, how would a bird and a lion fit together? Can we do this? I'm sure, well, we obviously can, but we need to see how.
What's really lovely, Michelle, is your kind of combination of really striking black and white imagery with imagery as well, that really gives it a lovely dimension.
I'm glad to hear that. Thanks, Jen. Well, it's amazing. This is the joy of collage, everyone, because, you know, I think that that's quite a good fit. It's like this slightly proud, proud stork atop a rock, kind of slightly puffing out. Let's glue this one. I think this is worth popping into position. I just need a bit more glue, one second. the glue's dried out a bit. You either have too much or too little. Right.
Just as a quick time check for Michelle and everyone participating, we've got about 15 minutes left of today's workshop.
Well, it would be really lovely if there are any questions as well. Maybe if there are, please feel free to ask me. And if there aren't, that's also fine.
Michelle, do you mainly work collaging with animals, or do you collage other things as well?
Oh, other things as well. I mean, the good thing about the animals and the plant life is I think there's a lot that humans can learn about the animal and plant kingdom. I think that we sometimes forget in our human arrogance that that actually some of these creatures were here first. And I think that really works. What do you think? I think I try to actually work with all sorts of images. And I think that partly a lot of my filmmaking is actually very interested in film sets of the 1920s, and one of my favorite films is a black and white, I think 1937 film by the Corders, which was called The Jungle Book. I've got a little Mowgli here, but the reason I'm mentioning that is it's this incredible film set. It's actually all a set. And there's a kind of animatronic boa constrictor, and there are, there are actual animals, but most of them, it's just an incredible film set that's turned into a jungle. And if I think of some of the other films I'm interested in, like Michael Powell and Emmerich Pressburger's Black Narcissus, that film from 1947 was completely shot on a film set. So I'm really interested in the collaging processes of film sets, because everything is placed for a good reason, you know, that everything is potentially going to be seen or read by our eyes. So the animals in this case are, it is about the animals, and it's also not about the animals, if that makes sense. It's about just exploring points of connection between things. So we've got the tail end of this common iguana here, and I don't know whether we can find a connection with this alpaca. I actually had a really lovely trip with my daughters to see the alpaca at the Horniman Museum, but there's a little farm there, and it's really an incredible creature.
We've had another great question come through from Marie Holman, and Marie asks, can we use newspaper cuttings to add messages to our animal creations?
I think that's a really brilliant idea. I would, you know, like if you, like I said, we could also brainstorm and write a few things with a pen, but if you have the time, that would be a really, really good way to kind of keep growing this. And maybe what would be fun as well in the units, if you're working with other people, is to kind of make a hybrid totems menagerie, a collection of them together. And it might be interesting to kind of make a landscape or create a neutral backdrop and place all your animals together. And what would be interesting about that is thinking about community and our differences, and in a time where we've actually spent a lot of time being socially isolated from one another, it just might be a really lovely collective extension to this workshop, where you get to you get to bring your different creations together. I mean, here with this iguana, I just tore along the line here, but this top line of its body seems to work quite nicely with the alpaca, and the little spikes add a little bit of strength to the softness of the alpaca's wool. I think maybe that's what we could think about, this idea of being hybrid. In coming together, we actually strengthen and our, you know, we strengthen our connections. We and some of the isolation that we've been experiencing has meant that we haven't had all those lovely points of contact that make conversation so rich and make us laugh, make us, you know, share memories with one another. So yeah, maybe if I had a menagerie going, which I've started to do, I would bring my, I'm gonna just cover the tiger up, I hope it doesn't mind. I'm gonna bring this alpaca in with the common iguana.
Question comes through, and it's from Elizabeth, and Elizabeth wants to know, how have you found collage to inform your filmmaking?
Yeah, this is a great question, Elizabeth. I guess when I collage, that of course is a two-dimensional thing, and when I make a film set, that's three-dimensional. But I think the same things apply within two-dimensional merging and bringing together of different object of different images, and the same applies to objects, because when I'm set dressing my film sets, it's the same as collage, but it's in a 3D form. So it's doing two things. It's helping, collage as a practice is helping me to bring together the unexpected and create something new. And it's also helping me to think a bit more laterally when I'm writing, because I can see that I might begin with an idea, but it might just be the straightforward path. It might be almost like from A to Z of an idea. But the collage element, whilst I'm thinking, I'll often have some nice music on in the background, or I'll be listening to somebody talking on a download, you know, of a lecture, and it just sparks different connections in the brain. And I think that's what collage is to me, and that really, really is very impactful on how I make my films. Hope that answers your question, Elizabeth. Okay, so yeah, I'm bringing together the menagerie.
Just to let everyone know that we're coming to the last 5-10 minutes of the workshop.
Okay, it's a bit crowded here, but that could work. I mean, if you had the time, and we started to cut around these or tear around these images, it might even be really nice to create a kind of diorama, you know, a long landscape of your totem hybrids. And that could work very nicely. I don't have enough room here on this desk, which is a bit of a shame. But we've made quite a few already, haven't we? And that's, I think, the nice thing about this practice is we don't have to be too precious about it. That's why I was sort of resistant about sticking things down to begin with, because I want you to be able to have lots of options. And if you have the time, actually leaving it a day or two and living with the images. I sometimes describe how I work with two-dimensional images as like images that last with you for a long time and stay in your head. So you can kind of carry them with you in your day. Like if you went to the shop or something, you could still be, I could be doing something a bit, you know, quite normal, like just buying my groceries. But then in the back of my mind, I could be thinking, well, I wonder what would happen if I moved the genet round so that the tail connected more. How could I do that? You know, so it's just really, yeah, it's just really about allowing things to breathe a bit and allowing things to sit with you for a bit longer and not necessarily committing too quickly. See, this is a nice little gathering. I feel like we could even bring back our old friend, the giraffe. The giraffe has been probably our... What's nice here is the legs really, yeah, you see I'm going to have to just do a little bit of tearing again.
So we're drawing the end of the workshop, Michelle. We've got about 5 minutes left.
Okay. Having too much fun and it all goes by too quickly. Right, I've just done a little bit of tearing again because I think that maybe the genet, see the kind of spots of the genet, that seems to also work very well and feel like we need to give, this genet seems quite, it seems quite gentle there, but I'm going to puff its chest out a bit. What happens if we do that? Ah, I need to do a bit more tearing to get rid of. Really, you can actually still have a decent amount of control with the tearing. Okay. Just for speed. Okay. Let's puff this chest out and still, well, that's nice, it still has, is it nice? No, not quite. I want to, yeah, that's good, it still has its arm in place. That's not bad because actually there is a nice connection there as well, isn't there? Yeah, I think I quite like this one. Let's bring its tail out into the foreground as well. So yeah, so you've got options. You've got, if you have time and you have some support, you can take more time to tidy up the edges and you can even, you know, decide to glue it onto a larger piece of paper which you might wish to frame or might want to keep it in your room, or maybe collaboratively you could get together and make this kind of landscape of all the hybrid totems together. And if you have the time on top of that, sharing some writing around the totems would be amazing too, because that would really unpack what you were thinking about when you made it and how it made you feel.
And that feels like a really brilliant place to end today's workshop. And I'd like to extend once again a really huge thank you to Michelle for leading such a fantastic workshop today. It's been absolutely incredible to see what you've created. And as always, we'd love to see everyone else's creations too. Thank you so much to everyone that submitted a question and let us know where you've been joining us from today. I'm now going to be launching a very quick poll, and it's just for everyone who's joining us to give us a quick indication of how you found the workshop today. That should be popping up on your screens now. Thank you to those of you answering. We're just going to give that another 5 seconds or so. That's brilliant. Thank you so much, everyone. I'm just going to end that poll now. Thanks very much. Thank you once again for everyone for joining us today. It's been a really wonderful workshop and a really great way of starting the new term. If you're still here with us, I'd like to share a little bit about hospital rooms and how the workshop today has come about. We're a London-based arts and mental health charity, and we transform inpatient mental health units with contemporary art. We're really thrilled that a lot of the units that we've worked with previously or hope to work with in future have joined us for these sessions today. We began the digital art school in response to COVID-19 lockdowns when our in-person work in units was put on hold. It's been hugely important for us to build a wonderful creative community where we can still join together and feel part of something special. You can find a library of our past projects and all of the previous digital art school workshops on our YouTube channel, which you can watch back at any time. You'll find a whole range of workshops spanning from collage to painting through to sculpture and even storytelling. So we'd really encourage you to have a look and subscribe. We're always uploading new videos, and by subscribing, you'll never miss a session. We also have a digital art school mailing list, which keeps you informed of upcoming workshops and the materials you'll need, along with any relevant downloads and links to last week's video. You can sign up for that at hospital-rooms.com. You can also share your artworks with us from any of our workshops by uploading onto our online gallery. We absolutely love to see them. You can do it anonymously, or you can let us know your name and where you are. We love seeing the works you've created, and it really helps us to build a sense of community together. I'm really thrilled to let you know that Digital Art School has also been nominated for a Webby Award, also known as the Oscars of the Internet. If you love what we do, we'd really appreciate your votes. This win will enable us to increase our reach across wards and units in the country and keep the Digital Art School running. You can find Hospital Rooms Digital Art School under the Health and Wellness category on Webby's website, and voting closes on Thursday, the 6th of May. We'll be back next week on Thursday, 6th of May with Flo Brooks for a hands-on workshop. We'll be using clay to create tiles inspired by springtime. We'd love to see you all for that. Please do register on our website. So from me and everyone at Hospital Rooms, thank you all again so much for joining us today. And a huge thank you to Michelle for leading today's wonderful workshop. We'll see you all again at 2 p.m. next Thursday.